Well, I was taken aback. I was absolutely alarmed and gobsmacked by that decision, and it made me wonder who really advises the president, because this is a man who was, so to speak, implicated in the Emerald Shot Commission, which the government set up to look into the election violence at Ayawa's West Wargon. Indeed, they stated in black and white that the man should be punished for his role in the violence. And the next minute, he's been rather promoted, so to speak. And I found that extremely disingenuous. I found that a betrayal of the very values of our democracy and the work that has been done by the Emerald Shot Commission has also been in vain. And it raises certain issues that I particularly have about especially the security setup in Ghana, because I've studied extensively about how the security hierarchy of other countries is done and how effective it has been in combating crime. And trust me, Sela, one of the most successful stories is with the Scandinavian countries, where the security agencies are effective and efficient in the work they do, and it has, you know, brought crime almost to zero. And the secret is quite straightforward and simple. Apart from the logistics, the training, etc., one of the most important strategies is accountability, where the security agents and agencies are accountable to not just the political elite or the government, but rather they are accountable to the people. So when it so happens, it engenders trust and confidence in their work amongst the people, and you have everybody taking part in the security maintenance process. So for the government to betray the Emerald Shot Commission recommendations in this fashion means the people's opinion doesn't really matter, because it goes without saying that this is a gentleman who has lost a great degree of legitimacy and credibility in the eyes of Ghanaians. Okay, so when you reappoint him in such a manner, Ghanaians will begin to wonder if really their opinions matter when it comes to security issues.
But
okay?
Is not clear from the white paper that was issued by the government. The government clearly didn't feel that the Emerald Commission did the job they have sent them to do, and they disagreed with this particular proposal, the proposal for him to be reprimanded. So this indication should have been very clear when that white paper was issued that they intend to give him more to do.
Well, for some of us, we knew it was clear. But for a lot of Ghanaians, perhaps some might be hypocritic and think, no, it is not really what you think. But the thing is, it defeats the very purpose of putting together the Emerald Shot Commission. It was a complete waste of time and taxpayers' money. Okay? I know, and I do appreciate how powerful a figure Bryan Acheampong is in government. Okay, but until we start looking at things beyond the personalities and look at the merits of the issues, okay, without recourse to political experience, we would have people always feeling bigger than the law. Because this is a gentleman who has succeeded in making himself the exterminator, the terminator, you know, and he seems to be rewarded for it. And come to think of it, Minister of State at the Ministry of Interior is absolutely ludicrous. It doesn't make sense to me. Because Radio, you first of all have to know what the work of a Minister of State is. In a presidential system like we run in Ghana, usually ministers of state are assigned to substantive, mostly cabinet ministers to help them do their work. On the other hand, in some cases, they give them special duties to perform as Minister of State. But the question is, was that really necessary at the Ministry of Interior? Because we already even have a technical advisor to the minister. Okay, so if you have decided to move the Deputy Minister of Interior, okay, fine, why don't you make him Deputy Minister of Interior rather than Minister of State at the Interior Ministry? That is why I'm not particularly surprised that the NDC is raising red flags, okay? And a lot of Ghanaians are also whispering and wondering what is going on, okay? And I must indicate, it is quite worrying, and Like I always say, we have a constitution in the country, but we lack constitutionalism.
You refer to him as that he has, his talking trait is a terminator and an exterminator. Does this appointment essentially tell us that whatever he is terminating or exterminating, is it the president feels it is in his interest?
Well, I wouldn't really be able to tell what goes on behind the doors, but it implies so. Okay, because this is a gentleman who broke all protocol, who put together a body that went to cause havoc at Ayawaso West Wagon, and it puts Ghana on the map negatively because it was an issue that came up in the international press. The diplomatic community were shocked by what happened because our democracy has come very far. When you compare our credentials to other countries, you would realize that it's gone way, way, way beyond other countries, especially in the West African sub-region. I remember during our last election, Gambia had just held their election, and Al Jazeera's Nicholas Hack, he had just returned from Gambia to Ghana, and I heard him say on Al Jazeera, Ghana's democracy is completely different from that of the Gambia. We are so advanced that it beats imagination. So for us to throw all these advancements, all the toil of our forefathers in such a fashion is something I find extremely disingenuous to the people of Ghana. Bryan Acheampong has carved a notorious, you know, disposition around himself. Okay, he was reprimanded. I mean, the recommendation put it that he should be punished for his role. Unfortunately, you have the president not having the balls to do the needful. The next minute, he's going to the Ministry of Interior. It does raise some questions.
Well, you mentioned the National Democratic Congress. Their suspicion is that this appointment is essentially targeted at the next election, that the plan may be for him to replicate what was done at Ayawaso West Wagon, but this time perhaps using either the police force or using equipment from the police force for the same group of people. Do they have a case?
To a very large extent, they do. However, we don't really for now, at this material point in time, have any evidence that points to such a scheme. However, those actions, like I earlier on stated, implies so. Okay? And we need to be worried. Because in the past, he used a ragtag sort of militia. And now, who knows, maybe, perhaps, I'm not sure because I don't have evidence to prove that. It's just speculation that they might perhaps want to use a legitimate state security apparatus, all right? And like I said, this is a man known to be the Terminator. So obviously, wherever he goes, you know, people would raise their eyebrows. And so I'm not particularly surprised that the NDC is raising concerns over his appointment. And he's a very powerful figure, I must indicate, wherever he is. He's able to get his way, things done his way. And so, if he's at the Ministry of Interior as the Minister of State, obviously you would have the police and other security agents come under him. He would be given instructions. He would be, so to speak, commanding them and all that. So, it's a bit of a challenge. It's really a bit of a challenge. And I just pray and hope the President rescinds his decision and get perhaps even a more competent person to head that position. However, it goes without saying that, look, the position of Minister of State at the Ministry of Interior is just extremely needless. It's irrelevant, okay? And I think it's just a burden on the taxpayer because you have so many security appointees and it makes it so convoluted and riddled with confusion and diffusion with everybody thinking, I am the boss, yes, I am in charge. Okay? And when it happens that way, it's a recipe for disaster because it creates conflicts when there are overlapping roles. When you have a single role performed by four or five people, it doesn't make sense. Our security appointees are just too many. A lot of them are duplications. Already we have a very well-established decentralized security hierarchy. We have the MuSec, the DiSec, and the RecSec. You know, and then those are the very top. There are too many. We need to cut down on them. We are a very small country. And a lot of them too, you know, everybody has VAs. They are full. We buy for them. We pay their bills for them. We pay for their travel expenses for a small country like Ghana. It's just way too much. Come on.
So the call is for the president to consider reversing this appointment. But do you think is one that he will sit to?
Well, we have done our patriotic duties as Ghanaians, as stakeholders in the security space, to tell the president what the right thing to do is. So he has the prerogative. He's the first gentleman of the land. He has the right to appoint and reject or even sack, dismiss. Okay? So it is up to him. However, tomorrow, definitely posterity will judge. So one day, I pray it doesn't happen when things don't go well. He wouldn't say, okay, I have you all so-called security analysts reading books left, right, center. Did you advise? Well, I'll be happy to say I advised, but it wasn't taken. But I do hope that the president would listen to wise counsel and do the need.